Happy Friday! Are you guys ready for the best show ever? Welcome to Date Night with Connie and Chrissy. I'm your host, Connie Henriquez, and my crazy favorite co-host, Chrissy Bowe.
What's up? Why are you so far away?
I don't like it. We have this fabulous fireplace in between us.
And these Christmas trees. What the?
And our pink tree. It's fabulous.
So what's up?
Dude, what's up? I feel like I haven't seen you. We didn't have a show last week.
No, we did not. We did not.
Man.
Why didn't we have? Oh yeah, we didn't have a show because my girlfriend was in from town.
Yes, your girlfriend was in from town, and
but we went to the Elf.
You know what? We did. We went separately.
Play.
We did go to the Elf play. Yeah.
What'd you guys think of it?
You know what? It was funny. I thought about you because I'm not a big.
Oh, thanks. You thought about me at that?
No, I'm not a big play fan.
Right. So Me either.
But I saw the movie, so when I watched the play, I was like, oh, it's cute. It was adorable. But right. I remember you saying that it had a lot of adult, stuff.
Well, they cursed a lot in it.
They did?
My seven-year-old nephews were sitting there.
Wait, they cursed a lot?
Yes, they said
that.
The B word, the
really?
S word.
There was a bar inside.
I know. There were a few bars.
I know. I don't remember.
And then my nephews would run up and be like, did you hear them say that bad word?
Is that true?
Oh, geez, here we go.
I love it.
You didn't notice it?
No.
You guys were
Probably
teetered up.
I appreciated the fact that they had some adult humor.
It was cute, though.
I know, we're by fast.
I know. Where's our, do we have pictures?
Jenny, where's Chrissy's adult elf pictures?
Well, I hope I only have
I know.
Adult.
It would be like number numero uno. No.
I only have two.
No, it
I only
would be
have
like
two.
Numero uno. No, that's not it.
What do you have?
Oh, you know
what? You probably have a million.
Actually, no. Before we even, our radio show.
David Levenstein.
How crazy is that? First of all, I just want to say a big thank you to David Levenstein because we had a great radio show on Tuesday.
Even though he cut us out of the picture that he made his profile picture on Facebook.
Yeah, we love him very much, but he clearly does not
he
want
put
us
balloons
in his profile
over our
picture.
Face.
Yeah.
I was like, what the?
That was weird.
That was very weird.
But anyway, so now we have a radio show. It starts, it's actually on Tuesday nights at 7 p.m.
He wants it 2 hours, but...
It might be 6 p.m. Depends on what week it is.
If there's an Islander game.
If the Islanders are playing, we're 6. If it's not, it's 7.
Right.
And it's on 103.9, and it's for Easton Long Island peeps.
Comac to Montauk, right?
Yes. So check us out Tuesday nights at 7 p.m. on 103.9.
Yep.
Or sometimes
where he grills
PM.
Us.
Yeah.
For
and
dating
if anything,
advice.
Wait, if anything, check that on Facebook, because you'll know our schedule based on that.
Yes.
But, dude, so I remember... Not I remember, but... In May, we met Eric Decker, and we had a blast. And now, according to what I've seen
I'm
on Facebook,
ask Bob about this
you obviously met him again, and Janine already showed the pictures. So how was Eric?
I was shaking this time. I was telling you and Jeff earlier.
I know.
I met him at the NFL draft party with you in May.
And he was super sweet.
And it was like standing just in close contact.
We're
and
like,
this
where's
time,
your wife? Oh,
right.
She's like,
I don't know why this time I was so nervous.
Really?
I was like shaking when I was talking to him. I'm going to ask Bob. How I attract him into my life.
Even though he's married?
Yeah.
I wonder if you can do that.
Bob's going to answer all that later.
I know. I'm curious if you could do that, actually.
Yeah, he's going to do it, guys.
If you could wreck a marriage, if you really want someone that bad.
Yep. I do, Bob. Don't worry about it.
Bob's laughing right now. I'm sure. I can't see him, but I'm just guessing.
No, Eric Decker is so nice. He was amazing.
He's very sweet, right?
He is. He didn't remember me, but in my head, he remembered me.
Yeah.
I'll ask Bob about it later.
All right, so Eric, he looks very, very good in those pictures. And there's the elf pictures, too.
Yay!
With your fam.
Me and my fam?
Yes.
All right.
And then also...
Fun. And you and Giuseppe?
Me and Giuseppe. Giuseppe
Natalie.
And I actually went to Ed Jarvis's, who's a big real estate bigwig,
yes.
I like to say, on Long Island.
We met him at the Baldwin.
We did, yeah.
Ball.
And he had a great holiday party for his company at the Emporium. So Jeff and I jumped into the photo booth. There's Ed Jarvis and his wife.
He's nice.
Yeah, he
was
adorable.
A nice guy.
He's very sweet. And actually, we went. Natalie and I went to a crown making workshop.
Oh, right. I was supposed to go with you guys, right?
But you weren't available because you were meeting Eric Decker.
Yep,
so
that was more important.
Exactly. Well, it was in a different kind of way. So there's myself and Janice Severnera, who actually hosts the workshop, and she did an amazing job. So
we're going to have her on the show, right?
We are. So definitely check her out on Facebook. If you're not sure, go to my Facebook page, and then you can check her out, Janice
Severnera. Why didn't you bring the crown?
I know.
I thought you were going to wear it.
I didn't want to mess it up.
Oh, jeez.
I love the crown. And that's us at Elf, the whole fam.
You guys didn't even know what was going on in Elf.
Because there was a bar, I told you.
You and Jeff weren't even at the play. You were sitting at the bar the whole time. You're like, what musical are we
at? I love
right
that
now?
They had a travel cup too. We got like a sippy cup. When you buy the alcohol there, they give you like a plastic sippy cup with a cover.
You guys are like, am I at the Rockettes? Where am I right now?
Like, this thing is perfect.
No, it was good. It was long though, wasn't it? It was like 2 and a half
hours.
We
got there late.
Okay,
I think it worked out. We got there late. Yeah. It was like perfect timing. Yeah.
Yeah.
And the Knicks game was starting too, so Madison Square Garden.
I would have went there instead and scalped tickets, bro. Why didn't you do that, Giselle?
No one was offering it. We probably would have taken.
I would have did that. I would have sold my elf tickets. All right. So what's your self-help
tip?
All right,
my star-loving life tip of the day is, and you know what's so funny? I thought about this for a little bit, and I was like, oh, this is so simple. If you love life, life will love you back.
Oh, I like that.
It's very simple. I don't have to explain it. It's like, there you
go.
No.
Well, Bob's going to explain it to us.
Yeah, exactly. Because if when you look for great things in life, you get them. It's so simple.
Is it though? People don't know
how
to do that.
But Bob's going to explain it. I don't know why people don't know how to get that, but yes.
Well, I have a great bestie of the week.
Let's hear. Oh, well, actually, I want to hear this because 2 weeks ago, I could have used this bestie very much so.
I found the remedy for us for our Tito's hangover.
Yeah.
I found this actually on UrbanOutfitters.com. I couldn't believe it.
I love Urban Outfitters.
Yep. It's the Hangover Cure water bottle. Okay. Do we have the picture?
We do.
And it's a recipe for the ultimate hangover cure. It has actually a filter underneath the cap, which is cool.
Okay.
And then you put, let me see.
Do you put Tito's
two
in
lemons.
It?
No, I wish you put Tito's in it. Actually, that would help. Two lemons, half a cucumber, 10 mint leaves, and then 3 parts water. And supposedly that's going to cure the hangover.
That's a hangover cure?
Guys, I'm going to try it tomorrow. I'll let you know. I'll let you know next week if it works. I don't know.
I feel like it's too simple.
It's going to be, I'm going to add some Tito to it. And maybe
they do say if you have a hangover, drink more alcohol.
They do
say
that.
I would want to vomit just at the thought of it.
I know.
If I have a hangover, but hey, I guess.
But we're always looking for a cure.
You're right. I'm going to, well, try it.
I mean, we drink the jug. Look at the jug sitting there. Bob, do you see the jug sitting there? That's what we drink. Whole show. Can you believe it? Bob doesn't even care. So. Bob doesn't even care about us.
I love it.
All right, so we're going to come back. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back with the amazing Bob Doyle.
From the movie The Secret.
That's
which
right.
Everyone and their mother has seen and loved and like that's, now has changed their life, hopefully.
I watched it 1,000
hopefully
times.
Hopefully so.
I watched it 1,000 times. I introduced that to my family, my friends.
1,000 times.
My sister shows it to her students at
oh,
the end of the year.
Oh, that's actually pretty amazing.
All thanks to me, Bob. Just want to throw that out there.
There you go.
But no, he's great. And he's also a best-selling author.
Which I can't wait to hear about all his books.
Wait, let's show his books right now. He wrote Follow Your Passion, Find Your Power, which I'm going to purchase immediately because I want to read that. That sounds amazing.
Yep.
And Wealth Beyond Reason.
Yeah, I want to actually read both of them, actually.
I know. We're going to get them.
And there you go.
And he's also the CEO of Boundless. Is it Boundless Living, Bob?
Boundless Living.
Boundless Living. All right. And you created a Wealth Beyond Reason program, which helps people create the lives that they want.
That's the rumor.
That's the rumor on the street.
I'm joining.
Yeah. On the street.
I'm joining tomorrow, Bob.
Cool. So we're going to be right back with the very amazing Bob Doyle
from
the movie The Secret. Come back in about 3 minutes after you get your refill.
Grab a Tito.
Blah, blah, you know it's ultimate. Big bad and bold piece, colorful roll with Excalibur. Yo, this is Marlon Greenwood, a.k.a. Ultimate, and I want you to watch Date Night every Friday night at 7:30 with Connie and Chrissy. Blah, blah, you know it's ultimate.
I love it.
Galaxy Luxury Coach is a full-service limousine and party bus company. Family-owned and operated, we are an industry leader with over 25 years of experience in providing best-in-class luxury transportation for your special event. Whether it's your precious wedding day, an all-day wine tour out east, your high school prom, that special birthday, or just an amazing night on the town, our professional chauffeurs stand ready to ensure your special event is truly special. Galaxy Luxury Coach has one of the largest and modern party bus fleets in the New York area. Our party buses are simply nightclubs on wheels, concert sound systems, light shows, lasers and strobes, multicolor LED lighting brilliantly lights your party bus inside and out. For corporate and more laid-back events, we will cater to your specific needs and requests. What sets Galaxy aside from all others in the luxury transportation industry is our attention to detail in customizing our services to your special event. At Galaxy, it's all about you and your guests. Galaxy customers return time again because they know they can trust Galaxy to help deliver those lifetime memorable moments. Step aboard and let your Galaxy experience begin.
Bob Doyle from The Secret.
Yes.
Bob, thank you so much for being here tonight.
It is more than my pleasure.
Aw, thank you. I'm a huge fan of you. I've been watching you for a long time. I know that sounds creepy. I'm sorry.
I know. I've called the cops a couple of times, and they're not doing anything about it.
Don't be a creeper.
I love this guy. He's great. That sounded creepy. No, really. I've been following you since The Secret. You're amazing what you do.
That's nice of you to say. Thank you.
Thank you. And so, you're here to help us. So
Yeah, totally.
Yes, apparently, from the introduction, I'm here to explain everything.
That's right, Bob.
No pressure.
And you got to do it quickly.
No pressure.
No guarantees.
So, Bob, so listen, there are people out there that have never seen The Secret and are not familiar with this topic. So can you...
Craziness.
It is crazy. You're living under a rock, guys.
Exactly. So can you give us a little bit of a brief... you know, history of what you do, where you, you know, the whole bit.
How you became a law of attraction
exactly.
coach, too.
In 25 words or less, right?
20.
I had been teaching the law of attraction for about 3.5 years or so before Rhonda Byrne, who created The Secret and the movie and the book and the whole thing, started researching who would she like to have in this film. And the film is really about the law of attraction. It was created basically as an introduction to the world of what the law of attraction is about and what's possible if you... you know, if you learn how to use it.
Right.
You know, one of the big challenges is this was a 90-minute movie, and you can't get everything in 90 minutes. And so it actually created a lot more questions, I think, than answers for a lot of people. And so after that movie came out, my work really became about answering some of those questions, and some of that's what we're going to talk about.
Like,
but, you know, my journey into the law of attraction was basically about me trying to find a career that I liked. I wanted to get into radio. That's what I wanted to do ever since I was a kid. Then I got into radio, and it really, because it was a major market, Atlanta station, I didn't really have a lot of creative control, and it just wasn't, it didn't give me the juice, right? So then I just started jumping around from different thing, trying to find something where I could express myself and have a lot of fun. And nothing I was doing was working, and that's when I started to kind of go, well, I, you know, it seems like I'm doing everything right. Why isn't this working? And that's when I started to kind of look down the metaphysical paths, the New Age paths, if you will, to kind of get some answers as to what might be going on that's not so obvious. You know, why does everything just keep falling apart? Why is nothing working? And that is what led me eventually to this whole concept of creating your reality, manifestation, visualization, meditation, and finally the law of attraction. But for me, it still seemed a little too woo-woo and new age, and I wanted to believe it. You know, I wanted to make it work, and I tried various things, but it just wasn't happening, and it really was because my brain needed some science. You know, I needed to know that I'm not just going on some woo-woo new age ride, right? Wishful thinking or whatever, and that there was real science behind this. So I really started studying the physics behind all of this, the quantum physics aspect of it, without getting too mind-boggling. But that's what eventually just turned on the lights for me. It helped me see that my beliefs about money and success were what was really running the show, as opposed to what I was consciously saying I wanted. What was really going on at a deeper level was really having the impact on whether or not I was going to be successful or not. And so understanding, really, if you're the work, if you will, around the law of attraction is figuring out what's stopping you, what's the resistance within you that's stopping you from attracting whatever it is that you want. Because it should, we're designed to have happen fairly effortlessly. However, we've been just ingrained with all of this limited thinking and belief systems over the course of, thousands of years, and we've just forgotten. We're just disconnected from that. So the work that's going on in the world right now, as consciousness sort of is expanding and growing, is reintroducing people to something that's very core to the very nature of who they are, and allowing them to start dreaming big again and creating visions for themselves and then living into them. So that's what the work is about.
Yeah, I love it. And you've been teaching it for what, 12 years?
Since 2002, whatever that is.
Yeah, 13. I don't know. I'm not good at math,
I feel
Bob.
Like that's like more than
Let's
year.
Call somebody who's good at math. I'm not good. All right, so Christmas is coming up, New Year's. There's a lot of people who are alone. They would like to attract a mate, such as me, Bob. So if you could help me, that would be great.
No pressure.
They all
want to
attract a mate such as you? Well, then you've got it made.
Oh, that was nice, Bob. I love you. So
that's all I want is just love. That's all I need. I'm just go from show to show, trying to get as much love as I can.
I love that. Love you. That's what I love about you. And you told me that a lot of people come to you, can I attract a specific person? Or if somebody's going through a breakup, can I get my ex
back? And all of that, yeah.
Now,
so
if somebody comes to you with that, what do you coach them on with that?
That is one of the biggest questions I get. So there's two main things that people seem to go after when they learn about the law of attraction. One is that $1 million, right? And the other one is the relationship, you know, whichever one they want. And neither one of those things is inherently bad to go after. It's just that you're skipping about 8 zillion steps. You really need to, there's no difference in attracting the perfect mate than there is the money or the car or the whatever.
Right.
But, physically, what's happening in the universe and how it happens is all the same. But how we think about things differently, like if you're someone who's been really looking for a relationship for a long time, now you've got a lot of significance around it. If it hasn't shown up for you, now you have beliefs that, well, maybe it never will, or what's taking so long and all of that stuff. And that energy has an impact. It has a real energetic impact. When you can understand, and we're not going to get into a physics lesson here, but if you can understand that everything in the universe is in fact energy, and that energy, you know, follows certain rules, and you can dig in a little bit deeper, you'll understand more about what resonance is and what resistance is and all of that. But basically, if you're in vibrational alignment,
we love alignment.
We're going to get into that, Bob. That's the key.
Vortex.
If you're in alignment with something, however it happens, whether it's intentional or accidental, which is what mostly happens, then it is a part of your experience. But if you are not in alignment with it, it cannot be a part of your experience. It's resistance. It actually pushes it away. The example I use is because there's a very popular definition of law of attraction that says like attracts like. However, if you take two magnets and put the two like ends together, they will not go together. They actually repel. Sure. The energy is not, the information in that energy that is those magnets and the magnetic field says, nope, that ain't happening. Yeah. So you have to turn it around and then they attract. So opposites actually attract in that case. And that's why these oversimplified definitions of what the law of attraction are, like attracts like, and what you think about expands and all of these things, while there's some truth in there, there's a lot of stuff that's not a full definition, and it can confuse people and they get frustrated, or they want to say, well, like it. They can point to a million examples why like does not attract like, and so they just throw out the whole theory, and it's just because they're not educated enough on the real science of the law of attraction. And so most of my work up front, you know, you mentioned the Wealth Beyond Reason program, I think.
Yes, I did.
That the very first part of that is laying the scientific groundwork, And it can take a while, you know, to get people to go, aha, because that's the biggest part when you get into law of attraction is this real? Is this real? Or am I being duped? Or will this work? Does it really work? That whole conversation, that energy just slows down the process. And once you understand the law of attraction, it's very obvious why. You're doubting, you're questioning the whole thing. Right. So you're literally pushing away results. So, and that's what, you know, when people are, and so that same kind of resistance shows up when people are attached to a result. I highly encourage you have a vision that inspires you. That's the most important thing.
Okay.
You have to be very clear on what it is and, more importantly, why you want it. Know throughout your body and your soul why this thing that you're, this vision that you want to create for yourself is in alignment with who you are. Who you really are, your purpose, your sense of passion, you know, so that you can step into that vision and truly be exactly who you are with no modifications to please other people or whatever. And so that's the first thing I work on with people is what's the big picture vision? And that's everything, the money, the house, the what are you doing for a career, the relationship, everything, not just because that piecemealing attraction also slows things down. So you really want to just know what you want as a whole and you know, be able to visualize that and bring yourself into alignment with it.
you're going to go into that later because we definitely need to cover the alignment thing.
Yeah, so Bob, how do you get into alignment or vibrational resonance?
Okay, so this is where visualization comes in. I mean, we are designed with this ability, with this gift to number one, we have passions. We have things that we desire. That's unique to us. We have this ability to imagine and create pictures in our heads, and not only create pictures, but as a result of creating those pictures and sounds and smells in our imagination, we actually create an emotional response within our bodies. We can feel it. You know, we get excited, we get upset, we get whatever. The thoughts that are going on in our head control our emotional state. That emotional state is that vibe. That defines the vibration. Like, what are we putting out there? What are we telling the universe that we're feeling right now? Mm-hmm. And that's what the universe is matching. So that's why if you want, let's say, $1 million, and you're visualizing $1 million, but the thoughts and the feelings going on in your head are, I'll never get it. How will I ever get it? What will people think if I get it? All of that stuff. You're actually saying, no, thank you. No, thank you. No, thank you. So with the relationship, if you are attached, like, I must have a relationship before I'm happy. I mean, just think about what you're really feeling, what's going on in there, this sense of desperation. And it's all about the fact that you don't have it right now. So what you're telling the universe is, I don't have a relationship. You want a relationship. You need a relationship. So that's what you're putting out there. So you're constantly attracting the need for a relationship. So that's the main thing that people need to understand. The desire itself is good, except until it brings you into this feeling of attachment, like, I must have it, otherwise I'm not happy.
Right.
The key is to be happy now, to feel the love now, and not need the relationship, to be whole and complete on your own. Let me address the specific person thing.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Because there's so many people who say, well, there's this guy in my office, or there's this gal who I know, you know.
Or Eric Decker. I want Eric Decker from the Jet.
Yes, and
whatever. And he's married with kids.
But here's the reality. What you want, what you really want, is the feelings that you expect you're going to get from that relationship.
Yep.
Physical, emotional. You believe that that person right there is the source of those feelings that you want.
Yes.
May or may not be true. For example, if you're doing that, if you're looking at a person who is happily married, probably not the one, right? Now, you can look at them and say, wow, that's the kind of thing I want. Look how he adores her, or look how he looks, or he's so funny, or whatever. Like, very clear. Wow, these are the qualities I want in the right person. But being attached to the specific person takes away a very fundamental thing, which is free will. Mm-hmm. You cannot get into them and make them want something, and it's not appropriate. Mm-hmm. Plus, let's say that you forcibly made your way into this person's life, and there they are, and then you find out, wow, they're not exactly what I thought after all. You see, if you leave it up to the universe to bring you the one based on what you're really clear on, then you're going to get the right one. But in your head, you imagine, you're filling in all kinds of blanks when you're just looking at a person from afar. And even if you're friends with them or know them fairly well, you still don't know, you know, there's that person and then there's the relationship version of that person. I think we all know what we're talking about here. So,
I love Bob.
Once you get into that and you go, oh, well, I did not, this wasn't in the brochure, right? But so Bob, the idea is, you know, you can use other people as a model for what you would like to feel, but do not attach to them specifically as having to be the one. Because as you do that, you're missing out on all the other things that the universe is bringing you. For example, if you're using them, it's all about this visualization. So you're picturing the ideal relationship. And so you begin the attraction process as you do that. But if you're focused on, well, I'm waiting for this person to come my way, you know, and they're not the one, you're going to miss, you're probably going to miss the whole thing. So it's really about a lot of trust.
Okay.
Is there something you want to say before I keep going? Because I can go on and on and on.
No, I love, and that's what I love about you, that you can keep going. But say we're trying all these things and we're still not getting the results, or we don't know how to change our energy to attract, you know, the right person. We're attracting the wrong people. We're attracting people who are married or people who are non-committal. Like, why is that happening if we think that we're doing everything that we should be doing?
So, so the honest answer, which is not the fun talk show answer that wraps it all up in a tidy little bow, is that there is definitely something going on inside you that is pulling you out of alignment.
Okay.
You may be doing the right thing, like physically, like taking the time to visualize and all those other things.
Right.
But I guarantee you that there's something going on about, it could be a deserving issue. It could be a million different things.
Right.
And that would take some exploration. You know, if I was really going to coach you, Chrissy, on where is this guy? Why aren't they showing up? I would be asking you lots of questions about past relationships, past relationship trauma, parental relationships. What are your model for relationships? Why do you want this particular type of relationship? What is it about them that you think they're going to give you that you don't already have? There's all of these things. And through that inquisition, you start to bring up, oh, this is an area of resistance, or this is a limiting belief, or somebody told me this when I was six and it's stuck, and it's creating a buffer between me getting me and what me having what I really want in terms of a relationship. So I was just, as we were getting ready to go, I wrote down a few questions that if you're struggling with this type of thing, you might ask yourself.
Oh, good.
Would you like me to
this is great right. for our viewers. All right.
So these are, the thing about this is you have to be brutally honest with yourself. You can't just go, yeah, I'm doing that. Yeah, I'm doing that. You know, or I'm not doing, oh, that's not me. You got to really be super, because here's the thing, you know, you can tell other people all day long what you're thinking, what you're feeling, what you believe. But what's really happening, you can't hide that from the universe, right? You cannot pull yourself off the grid. We are all one big ocean of energy, individuated into these human beings. And we're having this experience of being a human and physicality all around us. But it's all really just energy. So you can't hide from it. So no matter what you tell other people and even yourself, everything else knows what's happening. So you've got to be super, when we talk about alignment and getting rid of resistance, you really got to do the work. And trust me, anybody who's an adult in the United States has a boatload of resistance. I mean, it's just how we've been raised. We just have not been raised to learn to follow your passions, to believe that anything is possible, you know, all of that stuff. And it's hard work, money, blah, blah, blah. So we've got years and years of that and generations of that embedded in us that we have to deal with.
Yeah.
Now, fortunately, there are ways to shortcut that process, dealing with resistance and energy. We were talking off the show, off air about EFT, emotional freedom technique, any of these release techniques that help you get into your energy system. And I know, Chrissy, from, I think, prior conversation that you've worked with that and feel like you're not getting the results or whatever. That can be helped by somebody who really knows EFT inside and out.
Okay.
And also, sometimes when we're working on ourselves, we don't see the obvious thing that we need to be tapping on. We tap around it.
Right.
You know, we do the release work around it because that looking at the thing might be too painful or whatever. We block ourselves from it. So sometimes it's good just to have somebody from the outside. But here's some questions just to ask yourself as you are thinking about attracting this person. And be honest about what feelings come up for you.
Okay.
So do you ever feel like you adjust who you are or who you be out in the world in order to attract someone? Like,
you're being authentically yourself, you mean?
Yeah, not be completely yourself because you want to impress this person or hope to attract this person or whatever. You don't have to answer these questions out loud. You can keep them to yourself or whatever. But most people,
like, please keep them to yourself. Guys, I don't want to hear you anymore.
No, but they're great questions for the audience to ask themselves.
Yes, go ahead, Bob.
Yeah. So,
I was just making a joke because I was class clown, but go ahead.
I mean, I can, you know, I could explain these questions, but I think it's pretty obvious. Obviously, what we all want is to be, to live authentically. You know, if we're really going to be happy in a relationship for our lives or for however long it's meant to last, you know, we want to be 100% fully who we are, right? We don't want to get into a relationship and then have to close off parts of ourselves because, yikes, we didn't represent ourselves this way to this person. And now for the rest of your life, you gotta cut off that part of yourself because, well, they didn't know this about, you know what I'm saying? You gotta be who you are if you want to attract the absolute right one. Whatever you consider your faults to be, or no one will like this because I'm too weird or I'm too this and I'm going to tone this down when I'm out and about, you're compromising right there. You're saying, who I am is not good enough. Who I am needs tweaking. Who I am needs work. It's not good enough for a relationship, so I have to be this way. So what are you telling the universe? You're telling the universe, I don't deserve exactly what I want, so I'm going to tweak myself a little bit to get somebody, and that's why you attract the people who aren't quite right.
Yeah, screw that.
Okay.
Take me as I am, Bob.
Next question.
Bob doesn't even care about me. Yeah, Bob.
I love it.
I care about you.
All right. We care.
All right. And then I mentioned this before. How attached are you to finding that relationship? Like I got to have this. How, on the scale from 1 to 10, where are you in the I really got to have, like, what's your attachment level? You don't have to answer that, but people
all right.
should answer.
I can answer it.
And we okay.
I really want Eric Decker a lot.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, and right. So I would have a conversation with you, like, why? What's feeling incomplete? I mean, look, it's human nature to want a relationship. So all of that, we want to share our lives. We want, you know, it's wonderful to be in a good relationship. So I get why we want it, right? But when it gets to the attached, like, why can't I be happy without it? Then that deserves some exploration. And then here's a good one.
So wait, Bob, just a quick question.
What
would you say to someone who really wants a relationship but doesn't see that other aspect of being happy with themselves?
Well, that's another whole conversation. Why aren't they happy with themselves? And the next question, oddly enough, that I wrote on this,
we need another hour, Bob,
is how would you rate your self-love?
Oh, wow.
That's good.
Because truly, if you are looking to fill in a gap of self-love from somebody else, and that's, I know you hear that all the time, and I'm here to tell you that that is the truth. You must absolutely love yourself fully if you're really going to get the ideal one. Because that alone is wildly attractive to people. When you see somebody who's not arrogant, it's not ego, but they just love themselves. They love their life. They're just on path, right? That's very attractive. Even if they're not, like, physically attractive, you find yourself attracted to personalities of people who are being authentic, who love themselves, who feel comfortable with themselves. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
Yes.
So, and if you don't have that, believe me, it communicates.
Mm-hmm. But Bob,
it may not be obvious. People may not be able to just look at you and say, "Well, I don't know why I don't like him. I think it's because he doesn't love himself." I don't think that's going to happen. But it does broadcast. Like, we broadcast so much invisibly because we are all connected. And this intuitive, you know, we're all hearing intuition all the time, even if we don't know what it is. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when you walk into a room and sometimes, like, after somebody's spot, they could be sitting there with smiles on their faces, but you can feel the energy, right? So that's all, that invisible communication is definitely happening. So if you're communicating, I don't really love myself, then somewhere in somebody's psyche, as they meet you, they go, there's something about that person that feels unlovable or something. Mm-hmm. And it's you not loving yourself. Okay. So I know that answers the next. Well, then how do we love ourselves? That's another program.
That was my question, Bob.
Yeah, I know.
You're doing the whole interview with yourself.
I know.
Is great.
I've done this a couple times. So, Bob, what would you say? Well,
it's great. I love it.
All right. And then
Bob.
Here's a good one.
Yep.
Here's a good one. And this is a two-parter, really. Have you actually taken the time to fully create this person? Like.
Yes.
So you've written down every aspect of who they are,
yeah, Bob.
How you feel with them. Awesome. That's good. So that's a lot of people don't do that. They'll just see somebody and they'll go, oh, that looks good, or that looks good, or that looks good.
Right.
Without getting the clarity on, you know, like, what do I really, really want? So here's this part two of that question is, as you create that person, and this is, I'm not testing you here. You could answer correctly. As you create this person and you're writing this down and you're creating all these things, what's coming up for you emotionally? It could be a range of things, like excitement, but then also, like, and where is he? Like, there's sort of frustration and excitement, right? Whatever. I'm just guessing. This could happen for some people.
No, but I think the answer says, like, a lot, right?
So these, like, you have to, again, be really honest with that. If you're writing down this ideal thing and you get some sort of a, it'll never happen, or they wouldn't really like me, or I'm not good enough, or any of that stuff, that's that's stuff to pay attention to. These are the reasons that are slowing you down. So the whole idea with this, or attracting anything that you're struggling with, is to identify and deal with your areas of resistance. And that takes self-exploration. It takes a commitment to, again, being honest with yourself, being willing to look in places you don't want to look, owning decisions that you've made that you may not be proud of, whatever it is that's kind of clogging you up.
Right.
You know, if you've got areas in your life that you need to forgive yourself for, right? All of that comes kind of plays into the self-love thing. Because what you're really trying to do is create a vibration in yourself that is broadcasting that says, I love myself, I'm happy, and I would love to share this with someone who's willing. And I'm not going to compromise who I am to do that, by the way. So this is who I am. Love me like this, or we'll see you later. You know, and that's where the true happiness, that's where the juice is going to come from. Look, it doesn't mean, because I consider myself to be in the perfect relationship right now, but it does not mean that we don't have our issues. Because in fact, growing through that is part of my journey. It's what I want to do.
Right.
You know, learning how to. I was married for 25 years, and I'm wanting to do things much differently this time, right? Yeah. So these are opportunities for me to navigate disagreements differently, to let things go in the moment. You know, all of this is stuff I really want. So I invited in this beautiful woman who's funny and talented, in the same industry, all of these things. We love each other unconditionally. It's wonderful. We have the wonderful dog. We live in this perfect place, and we've got stuff that both come up for both of us and that we have committed to working through. So it is perfect. It doesn't mean it's bliss all the time. So, you know, but I've been very clear that this is what I want. So, you know, I think it's the clarity. 25 years of my marriage has given me extreme clarity on what I do want in terms of my primary relationship. So
Bob, can you take us through the step process that you did then to attract Lynn?
Yeah, I think so. It was just like, as my marriage was winding down, and I realized that, you know, this isn't going to continue. Part of my problem in that was because of the marriage, I was unable to really even create a vision for myself at all. So what I started to do is get very intentional about my vision. And I was also very clear, like I didn't want, like I really wasn't going after a relationship because I was just leaving one, right?
Right.
And I really wanted some time to myself. But I also was thinking, well, what would that look like? How would I like to spend that time?
Right.
You know, and it just became clear that I did in fact want someone to share it with. I just had a bad experience with relationships, so I was telling myself I don't want a relationship, but the fact is, of course I did. You know, I just wanted a good one.
Right.
So I started to really think, I did exactly what I'm telling you to do. Got really, really clear on what are the qualities of this person that I would want. And there was a lot of stuff that came up for me, like, could that even exist? Could someone so perfect be out there for me?
Wow.
You know, so I had to go through all of that stuff and, you know, do release work and all of that. But there was also a detachment because there was still that part of me that said, but I'm fine to be alone for a while too, because I could use the time or whatever. So I didn't have a detachment. I had a desire. It was in there. I was probably radiating out, you know, sort of a desire, sort of putting out the feelers, not even consciously, just like, this would be nice. This would be nice. And this would be ideal. And this would be perfect. And then that, in a nutshell, that's just how it happened. I just did, because look, everybody wants a step-by-step process. They want a procedure. They want a program. We're not, I mean, it can help. That's why I have one. But but ideally, you just want this to just happen.
Exactly.
You know, this is our natural state to create, to manifest what we want in our lives. We're built with everything we need to do that, you know, but it's the works have been clogged up. So, but ideally, we just go around from vision to vision and expanding and attracting the perfect people to help us realize that vision. We wouldn't be sitting there judging every single person that comes into our life. We wouldn't be judging every little intuitive nudge and say, well, that wouldn't make sense. How's that going to get me where I want to go?
Right.
We would just be in flow. That's what we're designed to do. So the more that we can get into flow, let go of judgment, let go of second guessing, you know, and really just let the intellect take a break for a while. And really just tap into intuition, a sense of love, self-love, all of that stuff. Being very clear on the vision and how you want to feel. That's really the most important thing. Like, if you got this entire vision that includes the relationship and the finances and whatever, you know, you really want that to inspire a very specific emotional state in you. If it's not, if you're not getting inspired by your own vision of your relationship or your life or whatever, you need to amp it up. You need to tweak it. You need to find out why have I lost my inspiration on this? Maybe this isn't it. And that's what happens with, you know, when people find out about the law of attraction, they go, I had $1 million. Yeah, they get excited about getting $1 million. But what they're really, most of the time they're doing is they want that money to solve a problem. Right. Oh, I don't have enough money, so I want $1 million, right? There's no specific, it doesn't tie into their sense of purpose. It doesn't tie into their sense of passion. It has nothing to do with a long-term vision. It's about, I want to solve this problem, or I want to buy all this stuff or whatever. But all of that is probably trying to fill a gap, a problem that they have right. in their life. I don't feel prosperous enough, so I need this money. I don't feel like I have enough status, so I need this kind of a car. All that's just filling up gross. You know, that has nothing to do with being in your power and all of that. So when you can create a vision that's around that, then the things that you start to attract are much more appropriate and not just, you know, knee-jerk reactions. Because if you go into work with the law of attraction to solve a problem, mm-hmm. this is the number two biggest thing that people do wrong with this whole piece of law of attraction stuff.
Okay, good.
Then all you're doing is the entire time you're trying everything, you're doing your vision boards, you're visualizing, you're meditating, yeah. you're telling the universe, you're broadcasting, I have a problem that needs to be solved. Mm. And so, yes, you do. Because that's what you're in alignment with, is this problem that you've got. That's why you shift your attention from the problem to what, you, what life would be like without the problem at all.
Even so though you have the problem going on in the moment?
Even if you have the problem going on at the moment.
Okay.
I mean, it's look, our ego tells us we must put all of our attention on this problem and solve this problem right now. Society will tell us that. We have to solve the problem. But I'm telling you, if you just check in with yourself as you're looking and suffering over a problem, it doesn't feel good, and it right. generally perpetuates. The thing that, and especially a lot of problems, we can't solve them in the state that we're in. When we're in the problem state, that's not the place where we're right. going to solve them. Mm-hmm. We have to move our consciousness into a more creative and more flowing state, more open to intuition. That's where the creative intelligence, this infinite intelligence that's put together this universe, we have access to all of that. But if we keep it all in here, like what we've learned, how will I solve this problem with the knowledge that I've accumulated over the course of my life, but that's right. all you've got, you're blocking out infinite amounts of solutions that could come your way if you just take the time to stop looking at this for just a little while, you know, take some time to meditate or go for a walk, just be present, you know, rather than worried about the past or fretting about the future or whatever it is, you know, that's what we've been trained to do, but right. learning to take control of your mind so that you can actually take some attention and feel great about where you want to go. And it's from, and that's where, see, when you get into alignment with where you want to be and that vision and you're really fully immersed in it, the universe is starting, it is in motion to bring that to you. And a lot of times what's going to happen as a result of this bringing is the solution to this problem. But you didn't think your way into it. You didn't suffer over and figure it out and stay up all night worrying about it.
Right.
It just came to you. Because to get from where you are to where you want to be, the problem has to go away. So the universe says, well, here's the solution, right?
So what do you think is the quickest way to get into alignment for somebody to attract what they want, a mate, a job, whatever they want?
The quickest way is to be clear on what it's going to look like, what it's going to feel like, why you want that, like really that clarity, and being and then the detachment. Taking the time every day or however often, mm-hmm. to move yourself into that state. You're moving yourself into alignment when you do that visualization, whether it's in your head or it's a vision board or you're okay. writing or however you're doing it. You're moving yourself. That's bringing you into alignment. And then be very, very, especially when you start, be very, very conscious of those little nagging thoughts that come up and say, no, it's not going to happen, all of that.
Okay.
And then in that moment, as that's happening, release it. Learn a release technique, whether it's EFT or mm-hmm. Sedona method or any number of others that are out there. Learn a technique that will help you to, as that comes up in the moment, not later that day when you remember
right.
it, but as you experience the upset or that voice in your head that says, you can't have this and here's why, work on that resistance in the moment. It's going to be a process of really just bringing down all of these force fields that we've been putting up over the course of time. So look, it may not be super quick. But the quick guest way is to be clear on what you want and eliminate the resistance as it comes up as you try to tune into that. That is the quickest way.
So, Bob, would you say the ultimate goal is to just try to do your best to feel good?
Well, I think there's something about that wording, try to do your best to feel good, that makes it seem like effort.
as best as possible?
It is. I would say yes. The idea is to feel good more than you don't. And so that, to do that, that means that you some of us have to reallocate some of our day. Instead of working all the time to solve this problem, we have to go play. You know, we got to pick up our ukulele or pet our dog, or we got to do something so that we can, in fact, allow ourselves, give ourselves permission to feel good. A lot of people, and I've been here, where you don't even feel like you can give yourself permission to feel good because you got all these problems. Can you relate to that? It's like, who am I to feel good right now? I got this going on, right? I can't take time to, you know, go for a walk by the beach. I've got this. I got to suffer over this problem, right? So that's the kind of thinking that we've been, that's how we've been trained to think. Like, it's irresponsible to go do something that feels good when we're in the midst of something. How crazy is that?
And for limited beliefs, because that's what most people have, right? That's what's blocking everybody from attracting what they want.
Yeah.
What do you suggest they do?
Well, I like EFT. It's a, you know, there's so many things about beliefs, and there's so many different ways to get at them. EFT, hypnosis, just meditation, just introspective stuff, like just sitting there and reviewing your life. Where did this belief come from? Okay. Like, sometimes you can just go back and go, well, I've got this belief that I'm not good enough. Where did I first get that? And okay. You can trace it back to the sixth grade dance.
Ha ha, sixth grade dance. Love it.
Yeah, see, it still makes me feel yucky. You know, well, that was sixth grade. This has nothing to do with me now.
But we want to know about it.
It got something in there. You know, we get...
What happened at the dance, Bob? I want to know.
What
happened at this
nothing,
dance? I want to know.
Absolutely nothing.
Bob, something happens, and I want to know about it.
It was nothing that happened. All dances are traumatic for me, okay? So, but anyway, so how did we get off on my dance in the sixth grade? I used it as an example. I'm going to put that on the list. Don't ever use the dance in the sixth grade. Anyway, I mean, things happen. We have some sort of emotional trauma, and it gets in there as a child or as a young person, and we make it real, and it stays with us into our adulthood.
Okay.
And sometimes all it takes is to be able to look back and go, wait a minute, that's where it came from? You know, and then you can just let it go. I mean, it is that easy. We do have the ability to just let it go.
How do we just let it go, Bob?
What's that?
How do we just let it go?
Well, the thing is it's a decision. Here, one of the other guys in The Secret, Hale Dwoskin, he has the Sedona method. Have you heard of that one?
Yes, of course.
So have you played with it?
Not yet. No.
Well, I'm going to ship you here to New York to help me with it.
Okay, awesome.
Bob's like,
it's really, when it boils down to it, it's all about a decision to just let it go. I mean, seriously, it's just, could you ask yourself, in essence, could I let this go? And you let it go. Now, it takes a while for you to, you know, it's not hard, and people overthink it. And when I learned about the Sedona method, I was like, there's no way. You ask these three questions to yourself, that's too easy. But, and my skepticism on it, of course, caused problems. But then I immersed myself in it for a while, and I watched Hale do it with audience members. I thought, oh, my God, it really is that simple. Because it is just a choice. Every emotional response we have is actually a learned response. We learn that it's appropriate to get pissed off when somebody cuts us off in traffic. We learn that, right? That's not an innate thing.
I do it every day, Bob.
We learn, you know, and then also people get sad about things like relationships ending. It doesn't have to be this sad, horrible thing.
Elaborate on that. Why do people get so sad then when a relationship ends?
Because we've got this belief that it's supposed to last forever. And sometimes, maybe it is. And sometimes, maybe it's not. Okay. And what people try to keep it together when it's clearly not. Like, you know, people evolve. People grow, you know. And it's just appropriate for people to kind of evolve. And it doesn't have to be with hard feelings and anger and all that stuff. That's all our crap. That's all human stuff that we've learned that, you know, we look for reasons why this isn't working. When we blame the other person or we look for behavior and go, that's the reason you did this, whatever.
Right.
You know. But the fact of the matter is the relationship has just evolved and now we want different things. We want to go different places. It could be celebrated. Hey, we're growing, but you know,
I love celebration of breakups.
Yeah.
She does. I don't.
The point is it is a choice,
yeah.
But it doesn't necessarily feel like a choice because again of how we've been programmed. You know, we've learned from movies and television that this is how relationships go, and this is how you're supposed to feel. And depending on what the thing is that broke it up, you should feel bad this long or angry this long or whatever. And people get stuck into an inappropriate long period of time feeling these negative emotions, and they don't know how to get rid of them because they think that they're supposed to. They think that they're justified in feeling that way, and they don't realize that they're by making that choice and perpetuating it because they're angry or whatever, they're destroying their own experience of their life, you know, just to be right or feel like whatever, for whatever the reasons are. So,
or they don't think they're going to find somebody better, so they harp on that one person.
Yeah.
It could be that, yeah, whatever it is. But it's all limiting beliefs. It's all limitation. It's all stuff we've learned that isn't true.
Yeah. How do we fix it, Bob? How do we fix the limiting beliefs?
Are you listening to me at all?
Is this time for a
text me later.
How many times are you going to ask that question?
I love Bob. Bob,
why don't
listen
you try
to me.
One of my answers first, and then
hold on. Good. Good, Bob.
Because I know you've tried EFT and all of those other
yes,
things.
Yes, Bob, I've done everything.
Right, right. But there's still stuff going on, and my guess is
except
that
UPS, you hear.
Okay, well, come on, bring me over.
I'm going to FedEx you here immediately. Good. Okay. No, that's what everybody gets stuck on. Everybody says the same thing to me. I've done this, I've done that. That doesn't work. I've tried everything. Why is it not working?
Okay, well, first of all, you now listen to you.
All right.
Okay, so you have to understand that at
that's
some
a limiting belief.
If something doesn't show up the way you wish it to, then you start to have the conversation around this doesn't work.
Yes.
Why isn't it working for me? Nothing works for me.
Right.
And then now that's your new conversation.
Great.
And
that's my new
wonder why stuff
belief.
Doesn't work for you.
Right.
You keep telling yourself and everybody that it doesn't work for you. And then your ego's like, yeah, that's right. And I get to be right about this.
There you
it's
go,
easy
Bob.
To make you about this.
You're right about that one. Yeah.
Right about everything.
You're right about that
one. Bob's amazing. I love him.
Exactly. So, Bob, how do you, or what do you say to a client based on the situation that you just said that really is not getting it? Like, what do you say?
Well, what do you mean? Like, you mean
like
a Connie?
Who I keep asking the same question over and over.
I would hold them to a lot more accountability and be way more in their face and dig. You know, obviously now we're not going to do this. We're not going to have a therapy session here, and it's not therapy.
Why? Well, I like therapy. Go ahead, Bob.
But a deep coaching session would involve a lot more questions and I, you know, so I can never tell why something isn't happening for a person until I have some really meaningful conversation with them and get them to tap into something that maybe they haven't even looked at for a while. Because if they truly have tried everything, I promise you there's a whole area that you haven't looked at yet. And it's finding that area that's going to blow it all open.
Yeah. So, Bob, this is a new question I don't think we've covered.
What do you do about limiting beliefs?
No. You must have gotten class clown as I did.
I did in 7th grade until I was traumatized in 8th grade and I never did it again.
Let's talk about it. I'll coach you through it. No. How do we tap into our intuition? The secret, they talk about taking inspired action. I never understood that. Like, what does that mean?
So when I first started all this, I didn't know what it meant either. And I didn't know, well, how do you know what your intuition is? How do you know it's not just a voice in your head or, you know, whatever? And so I really wasn't sure how to answer that question. And so what I decided to do was, you know, when I was working on fixing my own situation, I said, well, I don't know what this intuition thing is. I don't know what it looks or sounds like. But I figure I knew that ideally if I had my vision, then the universe was supposed to give me something, some sort of direction.
Right.
And so I thought, well, I'm just going to be open and listening for anything that's kind of out of the ordinary. Instead of me trying to figure everything out or what's my next tactical move, if something comes along and says, hey, have a conversation with this person over here, instead of second guessing it or wondering, well, no, I'm busy over here. I'm trying to solve my problem. Go with that. And that's exactly what happened for me, is it truly started with a conversation that led to another conversation that was interesting. It was fun. It was, you know, it was, I don't know, it lit me up. It didn't have any.
The volume?
It's on him, his end.
All right.
So, Bob, obviously, so listen, we're closing up. So can you tell us where people can find you? No.
Oh, my goodness. Poor Bob.
Wait, Bob, is there something wrong with your mic? We can't hear you right
Check
now.
Check your mic, Bob. I love him. I still don't hear you, Bob.
No.
We might be going. Bob. We're going over a little. Bob, are you there? I see Bob's picture. No.
All right, so Christy.
Take a quick break. We'll come right back. Oh, wait, there's Bob.
Here we go. We go.
No, there's Bob.
There's Bob. No, we can't hear you.
We're not there.
So listen, Bob has two amazing books. Janine, can you show Bob's two great books that you must get?
I can't hear it.
Oh, I hear Bob! Tommy, give us
minutes. That's all right. Bob, we loved you. You're an amazing guest. Let's promote Bob's two books. That one. And then also the one about the wealth, yes, which you definitely have to go out and buy.
And boundlessliving.com, where you can hire Bob one-on-one. One-on-one coaching. I'm gonna sign up tomorrow, Bob. I hope I get a discount.
Bob Doyle, you're amazing. Thank you so much.
Bob, do you hear us yet?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah! Bob, we hear you. Go.
Listen.
I got nothing.
Oh, my God. We hear you now. Go. Tell everybody where to go to hire you.
Come on.
Go, Bob.
Boundlessliving.com.
Bob, go. Tell us.
We love it.
Can he not hear us?
All right, dude. Until guys, just so you know, we will not be around for the next 2 weeks because we have Christmas next week.
I know, but does Bob hear us?
And we have New Year's the following week.
Bob, do you hear us?
The following week.
He doesn't hear us. Bob, tell everybody where to go.
Boundlessliving.com. Bob, come on.
We missed. I know, but I want Bob to bring us out.
But for some reason, they can't hear us.
All right, boundlessliving.com. Hire Bob. I'm going to hire
him.
He's freaking amazing. I love this guy. He's got a great personality.
Yes.
I'm honored to have him on the show.
Thanks, Bob. You
are
the
best. We're having him back when the weather isn't bad. We love you, Bob.
Peace out.